Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the 8th meeting of the Education and Skills Committee in 2017? Can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting? I have apologies from Tavis Scott this morning, who's unwell, and Fulton McGregor is running late but should be joining us very shortly. The first item of business today is a decision on whether to take a number of items in private. Item 3 of this meeting is consideration evidence which we will hear in the children's hearing system. Are members content that we take item 3 in private? Thank you. The committee plans to consider its work programme on the 22nd of March. Are members content that we consider our work programme in private on that date? We are planning to hear from the Minister for Childcare and Early Years on the 29th of March. Are members content that we consider an item reviewing the evidence we hear from the Minister in private? Thank you. We now move on to agenda item 2, which is a roundtable discussion on the children's hearing system. Before we start, I want to put on record my thanks to everyone who has contributed already to the committee's work on the children's hearing system. We have had a number of roundtables recently and are intended to promote more of a conversational style of evidence gathering. That said, I'd remind everyone to indicate to me or the clerks if they would like to speak, and I will then call you. I suggest to start that we go round the table and briefly introduce ourselves. I'm James Dornan, MSP, and I'm the convener of the committee.
Joanne Marmont, MSP, deputy convener of the committee.
Jennifer Phillips, I'm a panel member in Glasgow and also a member of the AST, the area support team. I'm the lead panel representative.
I'm Julia Donnelly, I'm the head of representation at Clan Child Law.
Ross Greer, MSP for the West of Scotland.
Richard Lockhead, MSP for Moray.
Hi, I'm Daljeet Dagon, I'm a children's service manager with Barnardo Scotland.
I'm Daniel Johnson, MSP for Edinburgh Southern.
Colin Beakey, MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh.
I'm the chair of the Children's and Families Standing Committee for Social Work Scotland. I'm also chief social work officer in East Renfrewshire.
Boyd McAdam, the national convener and chief executive officer of Children's Hearing Scotland.
I'm Gillian Martin, I'm the MSP for Aberdeenshire East.
I'm Ross Thompson, I'm the MSP for North East Scotland.
I'm Malcolm Schaefer. I'm Head of Practice and Policy at Scottish Children's Supporters Administration.
I'm Jennifer Davidson. I'm the Executive Director of a new institute called Inspiring Children's Futures, which is a joint venture of CELSIS, the Centre for Excellence for Looked After Children, and the Centre for Youth and Criminal Justice, and the University of Strathclyde.
Okay, Liz Smith, I'm a Conservative member for Mid Scotland and Fife.
Phillips McGregor, MSP for Coatbridge and Creyson.
Thank you very much. I intend to cover 3 specific areas of interest today within our overall theme, which is to look at how well or otherwise the reforms from the 2011 Act are bedding in. The 3 specific areas of interest are the feedback loop, advocacy and provision of legal aid. Having said that, we won't be too rigid and I'll start with a general question for the table. So in terms of the reforms of the 2011 Act, what has worked well and what has not worked so well from the point of view of the child? Is a child today better or worse off following the 2011 Act? So I've started with an easy one. Is there anyone that would like to take that on? So, as I say, I started with an easy one. Mr. McAdam, you...
I will start, if I may. I think in terms of the child, they should be getting a better experience of standard approach and quality. What we've done through the Act, we have created a system of guaranteeing better quality assurance around the panel members, the training that they go through. They now achieve a professional development award that demonstrates that they've got competencies. We've introduced core training that we require all panel members to undergo to refresh their skills. So the experience of young people should be better. There are lots of areas, as the evidence has shown, where we can improve, and we are collectively working through the Children's Hearings Improvement Partnership to address them. I think there's one point I would say from the point of volunteers is that we have a system that works. There are 35,000 hearings going on across Scotland. A lot of the focus in the discussion is around the role of solicitors, legal representatives within the system. But that represents about, I think, about 10% of all hearings have legal representatives in them. Appeals are about 3% of hearings decisions, of which just about 40% are successful. So I think it's right that we look at advocacy and how we enhance the experience of young people, but we have to recognise too that there's a system that's going on daily supported by volunteers.
Is there any way that it can be gauged if the child has had if the children are feeling that they're getting a better deal now than they were prior to the 2011 Act? I mean, Mr. Schaefer.
We do children and family surveys every 2 to 3 years. So for a period of time, we should be able to gauge what the results are. We did one last year which showed some improvement in terms of children's perception of how they were treated at hearings, but still indicated there was a way to go. So that is one method by which we can look at measurement. I may add that as an outside agency, I would support that one of the improvements made by the Act has been the sort of the national management of children's panel and also of safeguarders, which was another reform, and both of which have introduced an element of consistency of practice and support that has been sorely needed. I would also say that the Act has contributed to a greater thinking in terms of encouraging the participation of children at hearings, and that's still work that is ongoing. And we've got various pieces of work which we're producing through the Children's Hearing Improvement Partnership to support that. I think other elements which have helped have been more technical. I think the modernisation of grounds of referral gives children and families better reasons why they are being referred to the hearing. The use of interim orders has introduced greater flexibility within the system, and in particular allows children still to be placed at home under an interim order, which couldn't be done before. I think if you were asking areas of improvement, then there's one significant area which has not been fully implemented, and that's around the sort of Rehabilitation of Offenders Act reforms, and in particular the rules relating to disclosure of previous records of children attending at hearings. And there's been a recent Court of Session judgment on that, which has indicated that some fairly substantial improvements are needed there to ensure that wherever possible, children do not carry the record of their attendance at hearings into future employment, and there's an attempt at rehabilitation. The other area which perhaps is still subject to some debate is around the definition of relevant persons and whether that has solved all the issues or whether that's created more difficulties in terms of the sheer number of people who sometimes have rights of attendance at hearings and whether that creates a problem. That being said, I do not have a more succinct definition at hand for that.
That would have been nice if you had. Before I bring in my colleagues,
I'd like to reflect on that question as well, if I may. I suppose the question itself about children's experiences of the hearing system, may I suggest respectfully that we think about the children's experience more widely than that, because I think if we understand the hearing system itself and if the experience in the hearing is a positive one, that doesn't necessarily mean that children and young people's views have been well taken on board in advance of the hearing or that their pre-hearing or post-hearing experience has been positive. And so I think what I'd like to propose is actually that we think about this in the context of the UN guidelines of alternative care for children that gives us a much broader picture of the necessity principle and the suitability principle. And the challenges in the hearing system exist because they function as the gatekeeping mechanism between is it absolutely necessary for this child for compulsory orders and what is the most suitable placement for that child. So in that wider context, I think we recognize there are a whole range of tensions that exist, tensions that play out in terms of the hearing system in relation to things like the compulsory only when needed, but the urgency of children's developmental timescales. We've got the question of compulsion being placed on the young person, and yet it's the family themselves who will be so key to being able to ensure that things turn around and the families can continue to care for that child well. It's also tensions around understanding what is in the best interest of the child. And sometimes that can be at odds from what is actually what young people's views are saying, and the judgments that are required in those decisions are very significant. So you've asked the question, I think, about 2011 Act and whether there's been some progress in relation to that. I think we're definitely on the right track. My experience and our experience at CELSIS would say that the principles are the right principles still in terms of the hearing system back from based on the Kilbrandon principles that the hearing was established to deliver. I think the three biggest concerns that remain for us relate to, first of all, with the changes that the 2011 Act brought in, it has increased, or I suppose increased the power disaggregation across the panel. So if we have additional solicitors coming in, which are essential to respect the rights of parents, of course, if we have a changed role for the reporter, both of which have happened from the 2011 Act, I think it raises questions about the way in which power is dispersed around the hearing, in the hearing, and whether or not we have sufficient leadership to be able to take things forward in the way that's needed in the hearing itself. And in the research that we've undertaken with safeguarders and indeed with solicitors, where we've interviewed safeguarders, social workers, and panel members, as well as solicitors, we've understood that there's a real, there continues to be a misunderstanding of each other's roles, and interestingly, that those professionals each feel misunderstood by others. So it's not so much that people are feeling that they're misunderstanding others' roles, but they feel misunderstood. And so in the context of people around the table, feeling misunderstood, I think there's a concern then about, this is my second point after we talk about the roles being misunderstood. My second point then is it creates a bigger challenge for us in the hearings to be able to ensure that children's views are really paramount, that their welfare is paramount in this situation. Who is then understanding what's happening for the child if there's a risk of the power being dispersed? And in the context then of not necessarily being confident then about the child being the focus of the decisions, then I think we need to be looking at how can we improve that further. So as I said, I think we are moving in the right direction. There's been huge amounts of achievements. My suggestion would be that the next stage we look at is how is it, and indeed the CHIP is already looking at this, how is the quality of the evidence that's coming to the panel, absolutely the type of quality that allows panel members to make really good decisions, and that comes from social work and a whole range of professionals. This doesn't just sit with social work, but it also relies on skills of panel members. So it's great to see that the education of panel members are increasing and there's more consistency there. I would suggest that the next stage would be to look at how it is that panel members can be even more supported in relation to their confidence to be able to take really difficult decisions in what is a much more complex arena than it was when Kilbrandon was first established.
Okay, thank you very much. Again, before I bring in my colleague, is there any of the guests I would like to?
I concur with what Jennifer said, but we have significant experience of attending children's hearings across the west of Scotland in particular, and I don't think any of our staff have been to a hearing where there hasn't been legal representation present, and it's become part and parcel of everyday life in terms of children's hearings. It's not an environment that's conducive for children. It's hostile, it's adversarial, and it's also not in the best interests of the child. Whilst I understand that it's important that parents' rights are respected and supported, what we're actually often missing is what's in the best interests of the child in particular. And I think, certainly from my perspective, what's happening is that we often have 10 or 12 people regularly present in a children's hearing, and that's because the agency representatives feel so passionate about what the issues are and what the concerns are that they feel like they have to physically be present because the multi-agency assessment hasn't been respected, and often the social worker who's present is often scapegoated. We've had experience of requesting police escorts during hearings because the leadership isn't present, and that whilst I understand and respect that the panel members are all volunteers, they are not supported by the reporter in any shape or form in terms of the hostility that's present in the hearings. And I do think we have to be clear about behaviours in the hearing, particularly where children are present, because those behaviours are probably behaviours that are prevalent in our sheriff courts, where if children were present, there'd be special measures put in place to exempt their presence, whereas we're actually expecting children to be present. And so I think that's something we really need to consider.
Can I just clarify clarify when you say the behaviours are you talking about from the legal representatives?
In particular,
right,
yes.
Right, so they're behaving as if this is a court trial.
Yeah, uh-huh,
right.
Yeah. And I think what that often masks is their, I suppose, their lack of understanding of child development, attachment, family functioning, and trauma in particular. So I think what happens instead is to, because we have actually had solicitors who've actively encouraged parents not to work with our service. And our service is about supporting parents to be in a better position to support their children and keep children at home. So often when solicitors are instructing, and that's the information that we've been given by parents, that they've been instructed by their solicitor not to work with our service, which is a commissioned service, but it's also a voluntary service. And it's about keeping families together. I find that really quite concerning in particular.
Kate.
I think my starting point is that Social Work Scotland supports the children's hearing system. Fundamentally, we think it's the right way to kind of ensure that children are safeguarded through their welfare, because that is the point of it, it's welfare. I suppose in picking up the issues, it has become adversarial. And actually, if we reflect and understand the journey into that new system under the 2011 Act, none of us were prepared to have other people within that hearing room. And actually, fundamentally, we agree that it's right and proper that solicitors should be in the children's hearing system. But also the fact is that the necessary conditions weren't around to ensure that that was a seamless position. So, for example, solicitors who were used to working in sheriff courts, who were used to working in criminal law, were all of a sudden expected to come in and manage things differently. Okay, I think that what is curious for me is that the Act allowed for children to get legal representation, but actually very few children get legal representation. And I would suggest that's because the vast majority of children that are now in the hearing system aren't your 12 to 15, 16-year-olds. They're your very young children that actually cannot instruct a solicitor. So in some respects, my members, our social workers across Scotland, are now struggling with the concept of whether it's a child-centred system or is it a parent-centred system. And I think there's a fundamental discussion need to be held about where are the rights of the child within that. And I think the point that Daljeet made is a right point, that you've got children that are sitting through hearings for hours on end, actually with behaviours that actually, if they were at home, we would have probably went in and removed them at that point from their home, but yet that's allowed to be played out within a hearing system. We have reports from social workers who are threatened at hearing systems by parents, but actually, if that's not an unusual situation, but the conditions of the hearing system are pretty fraught. So everyone is in a situation that they're quite stressful and they're making decisions around that. And saying that, the actual Act in itself and the flexibility in terms of the orders, particularly the interim orders, to pick up Malcolm's point, has been really, really helpful. It removes the issue of warrants, and actually it gives much more flexible options that we can actually place a child at home with some measures that there will be a necessary a requirement for the child to engage, which is at times a bit of an oxymoron considering we require the parent to engage with it. But there has been positive elements of it. In terms of the work of the CHIP, we are working through, I'm a member of the Children's Hearing Improvement Partner, and we're trying to work through that. But I think that there is an opportunity to look at some of the legislation and what it has brought. And there's issues about relevant persons, and you've seen it in our submission about the role of foster carers when there has been issues about their care. But actually, the experience now is not a positive experience for social workers. And when we bring in the whole issue of permanency, and particularly when it is Scottish Government's desire to get positive destinations and permanent destinations for children. That creates an added dimension, but I suspect the committee will come and want to ask questions about that later. So I would just want to pick up the points that from the social work profession.
Ask Boyd McAdam a question here. I mean, we've had two witnesses there that say that the advocacy aspect of it has, well, the sorry, legal representation aspect of it has been quite challenging and seems to be all-encompassing. It seems to be there all the time, and yet, correct me if I'm wrong, but did you not say it was only 10% of cases that...
10% of hearings have legal representation, as we understand from the Legal Aid Board, decisions to support legal aid. But we also know from the search done that there are many examples of lawyers being supportive and working with the grain of the hearing, and I'm sure Jennifer can provide. She will have had experience of difficult hearings. I think last Friday was one. But there are other many examples where parents work and help, their lawyers help parents understand what their rights are and help the environment of the discussion. I don't think the 2011 Act, it did bring changes, but even prior to the 2011 Act, there was always a challenge for panel members to create the environment to allow the child to express their view. And I think having more people around the table has complicated that task. So one of the challenges for us is to inspire the confidence in the panel members, and particularly the chair, to manage that environment where tensions are often very high and taut. So,
Jennifer, and then Jo.
Right. I can recognise experiences and hearings from a lot of what has been said, but I have to echo what Boyd has said. Things have moved on from the point where we were hit with solicitors coming in greater numbers than they were before, and there were some real difficulties in the beginning. But now it is fair to say that in many cases, solicitors being there is a bonus and a benefit, because they are quite good at calming things down and asking their clients not to shout and, you know, put their points across in a reasonable way. So they can be very, very helpful. There are occasions when they're not, and I think what I've seen recently is something that it's in a small scale, but it worries me a bit, and that is that the effect of that has been that children are being excused from attending hearings because the stress that it would cause them to be there is too much, it's too great. And even recently, talking to a social worker about some children, the fact that they knew that there was a hearing coming along was stressful in itself, even if they didn't attend, because they had concerns about what was going to be decided and were they going to be put back into a situation that they didn't want to be in the first place.
Thank you. Julia?
Well, speaking as a solicitor who attends hearings, we largely represent children in hearings. And in our view, it's one of the big improvements from 2011 has been the availability of legal aid so that children can have legal representation. We think it's got a lot of benefits for the children as far as getting their views across, making sure their rights are protected, sometimes making sure their views are heard equally with other people who are represented in the hearing. It's an equality of arms thing sometimes. We would actually, on the rehabilitation of offenders situation, one of the points we wanted to raise today was that because the situation is complicated, we don't have time to kind of get into the law around it, but we actually think it would be helpful if there was more representation for children around that area. So basically, if children are looking at offending grounds or statements of facts that could be construed as offending, because there are these very serious consequences potentially in later life, where they can carry a conviction and that can end up being disclosed and impacting on their employment prospects. So we think that's an area where legal representation for children could be extended, so that children basically who are looking at offending get at least the benefit of advice before they get into grounds. And more generally, around the issue of the number of children who are represented, something that we find is children are very rarely aware that they can have legal representation. So we think it might assist if at an early stage they're given not just told they can get a lawyer, but they're given information that helps them to find a lawyer. It has to be independent, obviously, so it can't be too directive. But often, if you say to a child, you can get your own lawyer, they don't know how to go about that. So that might see an increase, I think, in the number of children and young people who are represented. I can't really speak for solicitors who are representing parents, but what I would say is that I think I agree with what Jennifer's saying, in that there are a lot of instances where when you're representing parents or when parents are represented, it can be helpful in managing behaviour. I don't doubt that there are instances of unacceptable behaviour. And I would also come in with what Celsus are saying, which is that I think if the rules were understood, and particularly if it was understood, there is a duty on solicitors to ensure that the hearing is focused on the best interest of the child, and the best interest of the child are paramount. And that doesn't have to conflict with your need to enable your client to effectively participate. But possibly there needs to be training around that, and there needs to be greater understanding, I think, of all the professionals, because it feels a bit as though the kind of adversarial, everybody on different sides thing is becoming a bit entrenched. And I think multi-agency training, we think, would be helpful with that, and specifically around everybody's roles. So maybe if solicitors understand other professionals' roles, other professionals understand how the solicitors are working and why they're doing what they're doing, that might go a long way to smoothing things out.
Okay, thank you for that. Daljeet, you wanted to come back in?
I suppose the only point I wanted to make was obviously that the 2011 Act was about, enabling much more effective participation by children in particular, which we do welcome. But I suppose what my concern is that often children are asked if they want to see the panel members on their own, and what we've got experience of is solicitors who are representing the parents insisting on being present during that period of time, which isn't in the best interest of the children. Just going back to Jennifer's point about how anxiety-provoking the whole hearing process is for children, prior to attending the hearing, during and after, because they have been told all kinds of possibilities and consequences that might take place. And for solicitors who don't have a relationship with a young person, who've actually never met them until that hearing, insisting upon sitting whilst that young person is spoken to by the panel, I don't think that's acceptable, and it has to change. And again, it goes back to how we support our panel members much better, so that they feel much stronger and much more confident in terms of managing that hearing, in terms of what that hearing's about and why we're all there in the first place.
Okay, thank you for that. Kate, I'll bring you in a minute, but I need to bring in one or two of my colleagues, Liz, and then Colin.
Thank you. Can I just read something from the committee perspective? I think it's four times during the last 10 years that successive education committees have looked at this issue. And whilst I think it's been corroborated this morning, that there has been some progress, it's not nearly enough progress to satisfy everybody, and clearly from the evidence that we've taken. Could I ask whether you think that the 2011 Act, 5 years on, needs to be amended in any way, or whether you think we can make greater progress simply by amending the guidance? It's my view that I think we're going slightly round in circles over the 10-year period, and the issues that you've raised this morning already, which coincide with what a lot of the evidence says, suggest that we're not doing our best to try to improve either the legislation or the guidance, or perhaps both. I'd just be interested in your views on that, because that's obviously our role as the committee, is to try to make these improvements.
Colin, do you want to come in at this point then?
Yeah, just briefly, Malcolm Schaffer mentioned in the passing about safeguarders, and I've had some experience dealing with safeguarders, and I have really three questions coming out of that. Firstly, How are safeguarders chosen? Secondly, do they receive any training? And thirdly, does the system work?
Okay, can we come back to those questions? Because that's quite a chunky session on its own. Kate, you wanted to come in on...
I just wanted to kind of pick up the point that Daljeet said, that actually if you look at the statistics, 60% of children that are in the hearing system are between 0 and 11. So actually the bit about instructing solicitors is a huge issue for us, and fundamentally with 20% being 0 to 3. So the ability of the child's views to be heard from a legal perspective is much reduced.
Joanne, do you want to come?
Yeah, I'm interested in... It just feels to me that the whole balance of the panel is now... doesn't feel right to me as someone who was involved 20 years ago. But the idea was the panel members spoke for the interest of the child, and that was utterly their focus, and that safeguarders provided a role to protect as well. And I'm very concerned, and first of all, I wonder in terms of social work... I'm picking up anecdotally, the pressure in social work is such that the actual quality of the reports that social work would provide in the past, which gave a very good steer to the panel members about what the key issues were, the conversation with the young person, separate conversation with the parents, so, and allowed them to have a focus. Is that being lost? And you have solicitors who can prove, as I give an anecdotal example, school provides an attendance printout. And a child has been at school 20% of the time. But they're able to identify one time when they were in school where the sheet says that they weren't in school. So that whole thing collapses. But the pattern of behaviour would suggest that child has not been sent to school. Is the role of a solicitor then really to demolish what is a picture emerging through the panel of what's happening to a child?
I think that what I hear, and certainly... And speaking to my fellow chief social work officers across Scotland and actually my own staff in East Renfrewshire and panel members, to go back to my original point, none of us were prepared for solicitors coming into the children's hearing system. And fundamentally, we agree that it's right in many respects. But there has been it's changed the dynamic of it. There is no getting away from that. It has... social workers will tell you that it's less focused on the reports and more focused on what's happening in that hearing at that given point in time. Hearings in the past, when I first qualified, you would have maybe 3 or 4 people at it at the very maximum. You can have anything up to 18, 19 people. I had a recent experience where my social workers told me that there was a hearing for 3.5 hours and with behaviours that were not in keeping to manage that hearing. And this is not a reflection on the children's hearing system. It's just a different dynamic. The issue about reports is an important one, because actually the best reports, it's about the preparation and the engagement of the child and the family before we get to hearing. And that is fundamentally the thing that has been lost, because it's all about the decision making at the hearing. But the start of the journey is that engagement with that child and their family and that multi-agency element of it. And I think that sometimes the Scottish Government are reviewing the blueprint, and I think that we need to consider that. It's what is the most important bit of the journey, and it's about that child being felt that they're being listened to and that they're being heard, and the report is fundamental to that.
I observed a hearing system, a panel session not that long ago, and my observation was that the existence of the attendance of the solicitors made the parents more passive. So they weren't being engaged with. I've sort of seen somehow this can really work. We encourage somebody really to say what their concerns are. Is there a danger, for example, that a parent would be reluctant to be absolutely honest about some of the challenges they're facing with a young person, because that then becomes evidence? And with the passivity of the parent in the panel, you're not really maybe dealing with the core issues. Now, I can remember, I don't know if this happens now, I looked at the figures for who refers. I can remember in the past advising a parent that they might want to think about referring the young person themselves, because it was a safe place to go. It was the opportunity to look at resources. It was the opportunity to, with people who were really expert, to think through what are the problems this young person had, can we work with them? It would look at this. That would never be a suggestion now. And is that not something then that's really been lost? The hearing system, it feels to me like a mini court now rather than what it was supposed to be. Take the legal bit out and allow people the space to be honest about, you know, the good stuff, the bad stuff, the difficult stuff, so that you could then put a support around that young person.
I think we've lost the good conversations that we had with parents, and actually the ability to ensure that collectively we were making the right decisions for the child. I think that the 2011 Act gives us loads of opportunities in terms of doing that, and I think we've got a long way to go. And I think that part of it is the relationships that are with in that hearing room and continuing to have open relationships. One of an unintended consequence of Boyd's role, and we welcome Boyd's role, is that ability to engage locally with your lead children's hearing person has gone. It's become a bit more fragmented. There maybe haven't been as involved in the local planning and strategic planning for children, and that's something that Boyd's tried to address around that. But I think that we're trying to revisit that through the CHIP, and in Glasgow, there was an engagement event trying to bring all the partners together to have that level of discussion. And it is about relationships. Fundamentally, the difference between our system and the English system is a relationship-based system, and it's not a legal-based system. And there's a danger that we blur the boundaries around that.
Just very briefly, can I just clarify here from somebody else? It does sound like every child sharing here is a court case. Is that the case?
If I could come back on a couple of points.
I guess I'd come back to something Boyd said earlier. It's only a minority of cases where there's legal representation in hearings.
Wrong impression getting, about the child's hearing system here.
I absolutely agree. In some of the more critical cases, you do get lawyers descending, you get acrimony, particularly where there's moves towards permanence. And, you know, if you were a parent, wouldn't you want a lawyer with you? You do see, I draw the committee's attention to a work that was done from the Scottish Legal Aid Board with support from CELSIS, a research report into the findings of legal representation. That's worth a read because it presents a balanced report, a more balanced report than I think is coming across this morning, to be honest. In particular, it may be squinted by the fact that of about the 4,400 appointments in hearings last year, about half of them were in the West, in particular in Glasgow. So there's a particular focus there, and there are particular issues there that you see in hearings in that part of the country for whatever reason. But I don't want to get away from all the positives of legal representation, and I don't want to get away from the fact that in a lot of the majority of hearings proceed without legal representation.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, I think it's really important that we get across the difficulties. That's part of what we want to look at. I was a bit concerned that all were hearings.
Can I just ask what are the positives of legal representation? Because I'm not clear about that. If it's to get people to behave, empowered panel members can do that. And can I just say, in the ones I observed, I was hugely impressed by the panel members, that if they have an authority and it's perceived as an authority, why would you need a lawyer to come in? And I mean, presumably over time there has been poor behaviour in hearings. It's not, I haven't required the legal profession to come in police hearings, I wouldn't have thought.
A lawyer is appointed where parents cannot effectively participate in the hearing. It's to help bring out the parents' views. As part of that, they can help and support the parent where they get emotional and upset within the hearing. A good lawyer, quite often a good lawyer will not say hardly anything in a hearing. They will be there in the background.
Jennifer, you wanted to come in.
I think perspective on this, because Glasgow where I'm a panel member, is probably one of the places where there are most lawyers in the hearing room. And, you know, I can only talk about personal experience and what I hear panel members in Glasgow saying. And although there are difficulties in some cases, many hearings do proceed without any legal representation and are not a lot different to the way they've proceeded in the past. I think there are a number of things, though, that fall out of it. Number of people in the room, which we've touched on, can be a real problem. And I think lengthy hearings was spoken about a minute or two ago, and I think there's, you know, a correlation between the number of people that you have present and how long the hearing takes and how contentious it is if you have solicitors there. And there's no doubt about it, that can be a difficult thing for panel members to manage. I would go back, though, to what I said before. There's good and there's bad. And I don't think that the only thing that lawyers can do is calm behaviour. They are there genuinely to see that parents' rights are being respected. And often they do that, as Malcolm said, without making a lot of noise about it. You know, so, you know, I think you have to have a sense of balance in it. One other thing that I would like to say is that I think children's participation, and I know there are different ways of having children's participation improved being looked at, and that for me as a panel member is an important thing. As I said earlier, an increase in my view in children being excused from attending, and you're getting their views by other means, and solicitors are challenging those views because those views are not coming directly from children. So I think we do have to look seriously about how we do that in a way that's non-threatening for children.
I'm going to bring in my colleague Richard in a minute. But can I ask, the solicitors who their norm is a courtroom and then they're in the children's panel system, do they have any training about the different way that they should be dealing with cases in this?
Solicitors who are doing legal aid work in children's hearings, which will be most of them, have to be entered on a register, and that's maintained by the Scottish Legal Aid Board. So that means they have to conform to a code of practice, which sets out standards of professional conduct that are defined in the code. Big part of that, the code specifies that when conducting proceedings before a children's hearing, the solicitor has to fulfil their professional duties to their client, but they have to respect the ethos of the children's hearing system. And they have to acknowledge that the best interests of the child are paramount, as well as promoting the effective participation of all parties.
So, but what that would mean?
They have to get on the register, they have to demonstrate competence in relation to, I mean, it's a variety of things, but ethos of the children's hearing system is the first one, I think. And there's also, and I've got a list here. Yeah, the ethos of the children's hearing system, and they demonstrate that by things like attending relevant courses and experience. So there is an element of it, whether it's sufficient, whether, again, multi-agency training might assist with increasing the awareness of the ethos of the children's hearing system. And also, I mean, there's an argument for, at the moment, you have to demonstrate the competence to get on the register, and you can be deregistered if you don't continue to demonstrate that competence. One of the things in the CELSIS report on the role of the solicitor in children's hearing system was talking about maybe more compulsory training, CPD, around and maybe not just for solicitors again, but around how, if legal representation is there to stay, how you make it work within the ethos and make it work differently to how it works in a court. So there is an acknowledgement in the code of practice that you should be working in a different way to the way you're okay. Working in a court. So that's known, it's just whether or not it's happening and what more can be done
to make sure
to make it happen more.
Yeah. Okay, Jennifer, you wanted to come in and ask.
Thank you. We've talked about the research a couple of times, so just to clarify, the research that was done on solicitors indicated that this was done in 2016, that the majority of solicitors who were working in the hearing system were constructive and valued and valuable and offering a valuable input. And where there was a minority, there was a minority where they were not following that ethos. And the recommendations, as Julia was saying, are really important recommendations about compulsory training for these solicitors. My suggestion would be one other thought to hold is that there is a Children's Hearings Improvement Partnership post that has now been established, that is a training, learning and development post to address the multi-agency needs in terms of training. And as well, we're hoping that there'll be some training that's clear for these solicitors in particular. I'd like to go back to something that Jennifer said earlier about the tensions in the hearing being really rooted in the numbers of people rather than necessarily badly behaving solicitors, if I may. And this comes back to something that we've heard from you, Ms. Smith, as well, which is the question about whether is this about legislation, is this about guidance, or is this about ultimately implementation? And I would suggest that there's been a great deal of implementation that's been going on, and efforts being made to implement 2011 Act and to ensure that children are held at the centre. My first remark earlier on about the concerns about the numbers of people and then this disaggregation of the power around that room brings me to a suggestion that we may want to look at how do we ensure that the chairs of the panel are really well equipped as well. So we've got a fantastic one here around our table in Jennifer, I know. And when chairs are really effective and strong and skilled and have the confidence to be able to manage that room, it is an effective process for children to ensure that the panel is making a good decision for those children. Where there's perhaps lacking confidence, that becomes, I think, a much more risky situation for the decision making to be taken forward. And so that isn't so much legislation or guidance. It's guidance, but it's really about supporting chairs to be the best they possibly can be. There's evidence in other problem-solving justice arenas where having a consistent chair with a particular family delivers better outcomes. We've never tested that in the children's hearing system, and perhaps there's a time coming that we can do that in small areas to see if that is helpful. But again, it comes back to attention for us about the fantastic value of committed volunteers who are the workforce for the panel, and the tensions between that and the realities of scheduling and managing the logistics of being able to get, for example, someone who would be a consistent chair. So I recognize what I'm suggesting is not something that would be simple and straightforward, but maybe the next phase for us in the future, which is about implementing the ethos of what we're trying to achieve.
Thank you. Richard.
I was really wanting to come in earlier on in terms of the debate over the legalisation of the process. And I do find it startling that an 8 or 9-year-old could be in a hearing with 18 or 19 people there, including solicitors. So I was just going to ask, firstly, what's the impact on the children of that environment? I know the word anxiety was mentioned. Is there any other comments or evidence about the actual impact on the children? And secondly, what are the solutions to that? There's been a lot of talk about the perceived problem. What's the solution to it? That's really my two questions.
Feel free.
I'm happy to come in here. I mean, I think there's a danger here today that we all bring our own perspectives about what the hearing systems and the experiences of children within the hearing system. But you're absolutely right. Would we ask our 8-year-old to go into a room with people that they don't know and actually tell them the story about their life and decision makings to be made? And actually, it would be anxiety provoked for any child to be in that situation. And the difficulty that we have is that our children that are in that situation have experienced a high level of conflict and trauma in their life and might present that they look more able to manage it because of what they've actually had to experience through all their life. And we know that that is sometimes the case for these children. I suppose I'm conscious that the evidence and procedure review is ongoing about the role of evidence of children in court, and I understand Lady Dorian's looking at that. And I think there's parallels about whatever we come out in the court processes about how we participate and engage and allow that child's views to be in the hearing system. And traditionally, we have to dispense with the children, and I hate that word, with a passion within the hearing system. And that's part of the business that goes on before we get there. And actually, I think that the 2011 Act has been much more helpful in allowing that discussion and that debate to happen. Because prior to that, children were almost feeling that they were compelled to turn up. But fundamentally, there's a different way of getting children's views, and I think that's what we need to be looking at. And actually, if adults are going to behave, irrespective of whether it's solicitors or parents, why does it need to be done in front of children? So I think that is our starting point, and that's what we need to look at.
That's a very interesting point there, because I'd written down as some way of pre-hearings that could take place before the child is present. I don't know if that's feasible or if that's done or whatever. Okay. Well, this time I'll start with Jennifer and then go to Malcolm.
Okay. We use a number of means to try and get round some of these difficulties and not always convinced that what we're doing works. We do try to offer to the child that they speak to the panel on their own. But as you've heard already, there are increasingly solicitors for the family that want to be there. However, a strong chair would just deny that if they could see it was going to get in the way. But I think the strength of the chair and obviously the other two members of the panel can be important as well. But yes, this whole business of how children give us their views is absolutely vital. And I'm starting to wonder whether, in fact, we should in some cases be seeing children separately from the hearing. Yeah. But I don't know if that's the answer or not.
Malcolm and then I'll bring it.
Yes, I mean, one of the things we're doing is embarking on a 3-year digital strategy for the hearing system. And part of that should be looking at whether there's other means by which children can participate in hearings without physically being in the hearing room. You know, are there electronic means? Is there video conferencing that's appropriate to look at that as a means? And are there other mechanisms by which we can ensure that the child's views are properly submitted to a hearing in advance? The traditional one is having your say a written form, but we need to get beyond that and look at whether there's more advanced technology can be used to help that. So we need to look and think about those means. We need to look at whether a child should be present throughout the hearing, if they are physically there, or whether there's not more use that should be making of ensuring that children are only there for a minimum period of time and can be excused from others. And certainly, you know, I saw a hearing that you chaired, in fact, in Glasgow, where the child was not present in the hearing, but was in the hearing centre, and you saw the child separately. And I very much take the point that where a child should be seen separately, it should be on their own and not with legal representation bearing down. So I think we're looking and we're working with, not least with the young people themselves. You know, we have modern apprentices, we're developing a young people's board. We need to work with them in terms of getting their advice, their views on how we can make their views most appropriately there at the hearing, and ensuring that we don't lose the fact that the child has to be at the centre. The worry is that you get lots of adults, you get the child's attendance completely dispensed with, and before you know, you've forgotten that the child is at the centre of the proceedings. So I think all our thinking is about making sure that the child continues to be at the centre, but we try to use some imagination within how that can be done.
Okay, Daljeet.
Sorry, say in terms of our advocacy services, what we've been using is avatars. So what we've been doing is iPads with young people, so that they're actually not physically present at the hearing, but their voices are being heard and they're communicating directly with the panel. And our staff are taking iPads and mini projectors as well, so that everyone can see the young person rather than all trying to gather around a wee iPad. But I think one of the challenges that we've had, and it varies across the different local authorities, is that because the panel papers have to be with the participants 7 days in advance, sometimes that the young person's views aren't heard because they're being presented on the day and it's not seen as being in cognizance of the 7-day rule as well. So I think there are variations, but I think there's definitely ways in which we can involve young people.
Okay. Before I move on to the next session, can I just ask if any of my colleagues or any of the guests here have got any other questions around the solicitors and the amount of people that are... Daniel, Gillian, then Joanne.
Yeah, so I mean, I think there's two critical things I don't think we've quite bottomed out in this session, and I think they relate to actually questions you asked, James. I mean, first of all, what is the case? Is it a majority or minority of situations where lawyers are present? I'm not quite clear on that, and I'd just quite like to hear particularly from Daljeet and Jennifer, just kind of, and is there a particular categories of cases? Is that the problem? So you get your 10%, but it's because that's at a macro level that actually if you subdivide, that you see them much more present in some situations rather than others. The other point is, what I've still not heard a clear articulation of what the benefit of the presence of solicitors is. Now, all I've heard is that they can provide a calming influence and support. Now, forgive me if this sounds flippant, but the last person I'd go to is my solicitor if I wanted to be calmed down. So what is the benefit? Now, I'm assuming that it's about information about the process. Now, is actually the concept of legal representation the best way of actually providing that legal advice? And if that is a useful distinction, do we actually need to look at introducing new boundaries, actually, so we define where solicitors can and cannot participate in this process? And does that actually need to be hardened up? Can we simply leave this to guidance and kind of upskilling panel members? Because what I'm hearing sounds like actually we need to be a bit harder than that.
Okay, does Andrew want to come on?
Shall I clarify the research? The research that we did didn't indicate the percentage of hearings where there were solicitors. What we did was ask where there are solicitors in hearings, what are people's experiences of that? And what it found was that in the majority of cases, it was seen as a supportive, effective way of protecting parents' rights and having their views understood. Where it was that majority, it was perceived that those solicitors understood how to protect the best interests of the child in the context of that hearing, despite their role of supporting the family, the parents. That it was the minority that was not seen to be able to maintain that ethos. So that I can speak to, of those solicitors in hearings, it was the minority who were seen to not be maintaining that ethos. I think it was Boyd that had said 10% of roughly in terms of the numbers.
That 10% figure, because I think that's a...
Well, certainly in terms of the service that we provide, it's an intensive family support service where it is about trying to keep families together, but inevitably it's also about preventing children from being accommodated in those situations where things might not be as they are. And going back to Joanne's point, what we found is that if parents admit that they have got, that they have got deficits, then it's seen as evidence that then other agencies can use. So that's why solicitors encourage parents not to admit those deficits, not to accept support. So therefore, in terms of our service, we're often asked to assess parents' capacity and their ability to look after their children. And it's all their children, not just, and increasingly, as Kate had mentioned, we actually work with children between the ages of 5 and 18, but we're primarily working with children aged between 5 and 12. So that's who we're representing in terms of the work that we are doing in hearings. And what we're finding is that nearly every single case that we go to, there's solicitors present. And that's in Glasgow and East and Bartonshire. That's the two local authorities. So it might be that there's variations across the country, but there's also one particular solicitor's agency as well, do you know what I mean? So it's not just, and I think it's not a coincidence that the legal aid was kind of reformed as well at the same time as the 2011 Reform Act as well, because this is something that's not been new for us. We have been raising these issues for the last 3 years, mm-hmm. because this has been, and for us it's just got worse and worse and worse in terms of representation. And again, I would just want to echo the point that I don't think any of our staff have ever been at hearing where solicitors are representing the views of children. It's
Malcolm.
Just to remind, there's always been lawyers in hearings.
Yes, absolutely.
Since 1971. Mm-hmm. But to begin with, it was only where parents could afford mm-hmm. to pay for a solicitor to come to a hearing. Now, there was a Court of Session judgment in 2001, something like that, which indicated that we were falling short of human rights law by not allowing representation to ensure that parents would be able to effectively participate in hearings. And it's those words that are the core issue. It's where parents are unable to completely articulate their views or completely understand all the issues within the reports. That was the purpose of, and at that time, an emergency legal representative scheme was introduced, where there were certain lawyers on the panel appointed by the local authority who would be given to families. The 2011 Act changed that, again, concerned about human rights implications, to ensure that families had a choice of legal representation, but that it should be covered by the Scottish Legal Aid Board, and Julia's talked about the sort of checks there. And if lawyers fall short of that code of practice, then there is a complaint scheme to enable issues to be looked at, which I don't think is being very much used. And that's possibly is one of the issues that we need to take forward. So at its best, it's about ensuring that parents, where they're struggling to communicate with panel members, that there's somebody there to represent their views or to help and support them put forward their views. And the concern would be, I don't see there's any going back from that if we want to be human rights compliant within the system.
Through the chair, please. The word that's running around in my head ever since I've come into this area is it's respect. There's an inherent tension within the hearing because the panel members have to take a decision as to whether compulsory measures are required with the welfare of the child as paramount. But those decisions affect family life, and that's where the lawyers are coming in to respect those rights. And as Malcolm says, we can't get away with it. I think Liz Smith was asking, do we need to change? I think there are small technical things we can do, but the fundamental thing we need to do is to change that culture and understanding. And there have been lots of references about the system. There have been lots of references to multi-agency training. And I think the 2011 Act, the cooperation between myself and Neil Hunter, the principal reporter, and the multi-agency forum that the Children's Hearing Improvement Partnership is looking at those issues, and we're beginning to develop multi-agency training to help that understanding. That's going to take time. The digital agenda, if we make it work, promises an awful lot in terms of participation, but that's in the lead-up to and in the hearing and actually supporting youngsters afterwards. So in the interim, I think we're very dependent on the volunteers chairing and the panel members. I think chairing is a critical role within the system. We provide management of hearing trainings for new panel members. Part of the core training is managing conflict within hearings. And even if a panel member is not in the chair role, they are there to support the chair. But that has to come with the confidence to manage the difficult behaviours that do occasionally arise in hearings, and others to understand that actually the role of a panel member is to move forward and take a decision. And we have to understand that appeals and challenges and making use of processes injects a huge delay into the system, which is deferring the actual decision that is needed in respect of the child. So there's something about the culture that we need to change and inform. Okay, thank you. Gillian?
I have lots of notes here, but talking about the role and behaviour of solicitors in the hearing room, is there a case for licensing solicitors so that they have to have a licence and training to participate and take on the cases that involve children's hearings?
Yeah, Julia, on
folks. Well, solicitors, as I said before, there's a code of practice, and also solicitors have to comply with regulation by the Law Society of Scotland. When you're in court, you have to comply with certain behaviours to be an officer of the court. So I think there are already a lot of things in place that mean that solicitors have to behave. And there's also complaints procedures.
A specific licence and training that comes along that means that they can practice in a children's hearing situation. That's what I'm really getting at.
So you would be increasing, because let's say what's currently in place is you have to be registered. So you don't have to have a licence, but you have to be registered. And to be registered, you have to comply with these competencies, and you have to continue to demonstrate that you're meeting the competencies. And as Malcolm said, there's a complaints procedure as well, where if people observe that that you're not behaving according to, or you're not demonstrating the competencies in hearings, there is a mechanism where you can complain about solicitors. As far as I know, the effect of that would be being deregistered, which would mean that you couldn't get legal aid to go to a children's hearing. Presumably, you could still go if you were privately employed to do it. So I suppose there might be scope to, this is what we were talking about earlier, with maybe compulsory elements of compulsory CPD.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Where you have to fulfil a certain amount or type of training. Mm-hmm. So you could make that register more stringent.
Yeah.
And you could, I guess, make more people aware of it, I think, is valid as well. If more people understood the rules solicitors are meant to be abiding by and are compelled to abide by. So I don't think you need to bring in anything separate, but it might be beneficial to look at whether you could raise awareness of the current system and possibly put more in place around the current system.
Jennifer.
May I come back to a point that Mr. Johnson made for a moment in relation to the children appearing at hearings? I'd like to point out an interesting, if not rather bitter, irony that we're talking at the moment about children not being in the hearing because of, for very good reasons, absolutely. What's interesting is also for us, we're quite concerned about 16 and 17-year-olds who could be in the hearing, but instead are being seen before an adult court. And I think that I call it a bitter irony because, as we all know, the hearing system was established predominantly for offence grounds and have moved now to predominantly care proceedings. And yet, the very reason we had the hearing system in the first place was to hear offences, and yet those are now going to the court. So there's an interesting mm-hmm. element here for us to explore about the interface between the hearings and the courts, I would suggest, and a greater engagement with the judiciary around this would be very, very welcome.
Okay, thank you. I'm just a couple of last questions before we go. We've got Joanne and then Fulton.
Yeah,
and
then
we'll move on to something else.
I mean, I get the fact that parents should be able to be supported to participate. Why do they need legal representation to do that? Is there not the same kind of advocacy role that we see for young people could equally be applied to adults? And I know in past social workers, and part of the report is to advocate, if not to advocate, is to explain and describe the family situation, the parent situation. And I wonder whether, in fact, well, two things. Is there not a conflict between the interest of the parent and the interest of the child? And the role of the panel, the hearing system, is to support the child, and therefore there shouldn't be an equivalence. I mean, because these are big, big issues that a hearing system's identifying and having to deal with. And if you've got somebody whose only role is to say whatever needs to be said on behalf of the adult in a room, I'm not quite sure whether that then becomes challenging enough in terms of what the hearing has also been able to do, which is to challenge maybe some of the behaviours of adults. And are we now ending up in a place, when I accept there's only a small proportion of got legal representation, but presumably the hearing system, the idea was to take it out of the court system and to try and describe the situation, not ascribe blame, but find solutions. But this feels like it's really like a family court, but not quite so aggressive as perhaps you'd find in other parts of. And should we not just be honest and say that actually bits of the system should just go into a court system, and where the people are of like mind or are willing enough to come together, then that's where the hearing system would apply. It feels to me as if we're trying to get mixed. And I suppose the final point is, I want again to know, is there an issue of resources for social work? Is there actually an issue about the ability to do that kind of work beforehand, and whether, you know, in terms of advocacy, you actually can, you can find a different system from the one that we have just now.
Boyd, I get the impression you were wanting to come in.
I suppose part of it run is just back to this word respect. Would legal representatives behave in the way they do in a hearing in front of a sheriff? I think there's something about the respect for the authority of the children's panel members. They are taking decisions, and we've got to elevate that somehow so that people understand this is a tribunal. It is a legal process. It impacts on rights. But the behaviours in the room at times can be disruptive and adverse for the child, and that's what we're trying to avoid. But I think the ethos of the system is right. I think the forum to have the dialogue, and that is a challenge for these 2,500 volunteers that are part of the national panel, is to be able to manage that and take move forward and create that environment. And I think there's a lot more we could do in terms of supporting those volunteers, but we already place a huge demand on them. They're doing sort of 14 three-hour sessions a year on average. They're preparing for the papers, they're doing training, let alone the volunteer management of the system, which Jennifer can talk about. But there's, I think, volunteer element drawn from the community is a critical part of our system. And I think we tap into Scottish society through having the volunteers.
They've been put up against somebody whose mindset and day job is not what is right and what is wrong, it's what they can win. And I just, you know, why should it not be an advocate? And in what, I mean, where somebody might have been willing, if they're in my recollection of hearings in the past, where you get the opportunity to test, why did you do that? What do you think about this? And your lawyer's saying, don't say that. The actual, the parent becomes very passive in those circumstances. It's not active engagement. And I wonder how we strip back to where that original idea was, that people were treated with respect when they come in the sense that people were prepared to recognise the dilemmas and all the challenges that they faced. But I would have thought a lawyer putting your hand in your arm and saying, I don't think that's a good idea to say that, doesn't actually deal, doesn't find solutions to problems, does it? It kind of, they become, the danger is that they actually become passive and retreat from what might be solutions for their family.
And I think the legal aid, and Malcolm and others are far better to comment on the criteria for legal aid to support lawyers. It's at a level where either the parent isn't considered able to participate. If the lawyers aren't there, they are part of that forum, that discussion, whether supported by social work or others within the system. And I come back to my statement at the start that I think we have to recognise that for 90% of hearings, lawyers are not there, and that discussion that is integral to the system is taking place. I think you had a question about social work resources, which I'm sure I know Kate's answer to that, Chair. But
where do I start? Okay. I think that actually it's curious that you've, Joanne, that you've asked that question, because I just want to reflect about where social work is. Social work in Scotland is under significant amount of pressure. It is the service in many respects that works with the most targeted service for children within Scotland, but one that hasn't had the benefits of perhaps Macron's and or the teaching or the nursing profession in terms of the health visitors applications, and in many respects aren't protected necessarily from efficiencies within in terms of the budget rationalisation that goes on. Nevertheless, the focus on looked after children and the outcomes and the best outcomes are at the heart of what social workers do best, because these are our most disadvantaged children, and actually having that ability to go in and make a difference is important. And I'll just revisit what I said at the very beginning. The conditions to making a good hearing starts before that hearing, getting that child in that hearing room. So time is the greatest precious commodity for a social worker. And at times, social workers are stretched to have that time, because they have to deal with a whole load of different priorities, child protection through the day. They could have a child protection investigation and have to be in a meeting in the afternoon. And I think these are the fundamental dilemmas that social workers deal straight away. I think that sometimes that actually the ability to engage, because part of going out and preparing a report, you have to engage the parent in that report. And fundamentally, if the vast majority of children that are under 12, and particularly are 0 to 3, or 25% that are in the hearing system, the parent, in many respects, are key to that. So having the time to have that engagement and to develop it. Now, the most important bit is about sharing that plan. We've got the child's plan. We've got the implementation of GIFEC. Social Work weren't given any additional resources as around the implementation of GIFEC. It was focused on a much more early intervention approach, a universal service approach. But nevertheless, we have actually embraced GIFEC because we see the possibilities of GIFEC having the one child's plan. But again, that takes time. And for having that really good, robust assessment, you need to be talking to your partners, which in the main are education and health, to develop that plan for the child, which takes time. The situation is variable across Scotland in terms of social work resources.
Clarify, would that be because that the funding for social work comes from local authorities and it depends on what priority the local authorities put on social work?
Well, not necessarily, because the funding comes from different places. You know, historically, we've had monies from Sure Start, historically. We've had monies from different funding streams.
The core funding for social work is a local authority.
Yeah, well, the core funding for social work, yes, but there has been additional funding that has went in that has been mainstreamed over the year. And just like anything, it's a movable feast. We can't compare one bit of Scotland from the other bit of Scotland. And but irrespective, we only have the one budget nationally, and the national priorities need to be given around that. And there needs to be a broader debate. Where does social work sit in that? But actually, sometimes the best bit about social workers is the their creativity and how they do the engagement with children. But time is of the essence to make sure that we get that level of quality.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Phil.
Much. I'd actually like to pick up a point that Joanne Malint made and say that in general, as a social worker myself, practising social work before becoming an MSP, I would agree. I would like to see a situation where there's no lawyers in children's hearing because it goes against the ethos of it. However, I do have to say, having been in the decision process many, many times, sometimes we're talking about the most difficult decisions that can ever be made for people. And if we're actually saying that the parents, because let's face it, I mean, I think Kate would acknowledge them. I would like to say it's a small amount of time, but we do sometimes get it wrong. And the recommendations that we make as a local authority and as organisations. And if we are actually saying that parents aren't entitled to legal representation, that is a difficult road. What I would maybe say is what there needs to be a discussion about is where does that legal representation come in, because I would agree with the general consensus today that should it be in the context of the hearing. Just as I mentioned there, I'll just declare for the record that an interest, I'm still a member of the Scottish Social Services Council, and I actually worked in children and families for 8 years, so I worked between 2004 and 2012, so the new Act was just getting implemented as I was leaving on to a new role which had limited contact with the hearing system. And I would say that lawyers have always been present at hearings, you know, regularly, but are probably still about that 10% rate. And the numbers in the rooms that we talked about today, that's not been post-2011. I've been at hearings where there's been 20 folk in the room in 06, 07. You know, that type of time. So these issues are there, and I think actually, if I remember right, and I don't know if Kate would agree, when the new Act was coming out, there was a lot of hope, you know, that it was going to change a lot of these things. And actually, I suppose what I'm reflecting today is I'm disappointed, as Liz has indicated, that actually we're hearing the same things. So I would like to kind of put that in that context, that some of the things we're hearing today, for me, it's not because of the 2011 Act, it's actually, has the 2011 Act actually done anything to change that? So what I would like to do is, because I do realise that given my experience, I'm not actually here to give evidence, and I wanted to ask the panel members I do apologise, what they think about you know, some of the issues. I think is where hearings are held, because I think we really, really need to make them more child friendly. And I've always thought to myself, you know, all the hearings that I went to, and it might be different at different parts of the country, but all the ones that I went across, mainly Lanarkshire, but also in Glasgow and elsewhere, is they were in rooms, tables, you know, very, very kind of formal. And I've always thought to myself, why not have them in? We need to maybe think out of the box. schools, people's homes, and also in terms of having somebody there, you know, a key person, you know, that the child trusts the most. It's maybe not always social worker, you know, maybe a teacher or somebody else in their life that person's there with them to settle them. And I know there is sometimes provision for that, but it's not always the case. So I just want to know what the panel think about, you know, about that, about maybe thinking out the box about where we can hold hands. And it, you know, people say I've got my committee to play. Bad John today, Daniel Johnson, also spoke in that debate yesterday. And, you know, if a kid's four, why not have loads of toys around them? You know, being serious. You know, but there's no need for them to have to sit there and feel that if they move, the parent or one of the panel members says, no, you need to get back, sit back down, don't run about. Mm. Just let them run about. You'll get more from that. Panel members will get more from that than anything else. So that was my question.
Thanks, Malcolm, the point.
We are in a programme of redesigning our hearing rooms, having taken advice from young people, and in particular have removed the big table and produced rather more comforting soft furnishings and colours, very much following them. So places like Perth, Inverness, Glasgow, Irvine are examples, and we hope to use that in more and more centres. And if committee members want to visit any of those hearing rooms and see, please feel free to do so. They do. I've observed hearings in those rooms, and they do make a difference. They really do. And yes, the provision of toys, play areas for young people, again, is something we're looking at. Waiting room provision for different types of young people, be it an older young person or younger person. Interview rooms where people can speak to children, young people, before and after the hearing. So we're trying to put quite a lot of effort into that, and we believe that the early results demonstrate exactly what you're looking at, that it's a more comfortable environment for the holding of hearings and helps just reduce some element of that tension and formality.
Anything else you want to share on that point?
On that point, I think the importance is the preparation, and young people have a right to bring a representative along with them to the hearing. Jennifer can comment about active children within hearings. I just remember Colin Beattie did ask about safeguarders. No one around the table, I think, has specific responsibility for them, but there is a national panel of safeguarders. They undergo a programme of training, and maybe Jennifer might...
We're on to that in a minute.
Jennifer might comment on how it works.
It's not working. We do have one of these redesigned rooms, which was redesigned with input from young people who'd been in the system. So, you know, their views were taken into account. And what Malcolm has said is true. We've seen a big difference in that. We have two more coming on stream shortly. Glasgow has three areas. Because it's so big, we're divided in three to make it manageable. So we will now have one of these rooms for each of the areas. It does seem to remove some of the tensions in the room, which is a real bonus as well. The difficulty of children playing with toys in the room, obviously, if there's a lot of noise going on, but I think that is minor compared to the noise that some parents make. So I don't think it's really a huge issue. It certainly hasn't seemed to be for panel members operating in that room.
Maybe we should get some toys for the parents then as well. Ross?
Thanks, Convener. It sounds like a terrible cliche to say that we've, on the whole, had a very child-centred discussion, but I think that is important. What we found, though, as a committee in other areas of our work, is the value of getting direct input to our committee work from children, young people, or from those who've had that direct experience. So the question I would like to ask is, for us to take this work forward, how would you expect us to engage directly with children, young people, or those who have been a child or young person who's gone through this process?
Yes, Kate.
I'm really conscious that the written branch review has been announced and Fiona Duncan is the chair. I would suggest that's maybe some of the things that may well come out. Jennifer would be able to know better than me, as CELSIS are providing the secretariat. I think that it's a good point. We can sit there and talk as our own agencies, and actually that fundamentally the voices of the child and the young person are key to this. And it's about, there is various engagement strategies across the board. Who Cares do fantastic work with our looked after children. I think that it's fantastic that SCRA and CHS have set up their own board with young people. We've got champions boards that have now been developed across the board nationally. But it's how we do that and how we truly bring that in, that it's not fragmented and it is truly a national approach. And maybe the written branch review, Jennifer?
It's probably too early to say, Jennifer.
To say how that will be brought in, but I think it's a really important question you're asking, and I would suggest that bringing young people here would be quite a different experience and a different set of information you'd get than if you went to them. And so my suggestion would be to engage with organisations that are working directly with young people. Daljeet's organisation is one of them, and ask to go and meet with them in their in a nice, friendly, colourful toy.
Yes, Daljeet.
Sorry, Ross, that we've actually already had a direct
request from
this committee in terms of young people, but they've been asked to come here. And I think it's really important that you go to them because, one, it's a school day as well, so they're missing school. So in terms of travelling, it's a whole day they'll miss, whereas actually if you went to them, maybe in school settings or in some of the projects that they're actually comfortable with.
Can I just make it clear, Daljeet, that we do that regularly, that we go out and visit regularly? This was really about giving the young people a chance to speak to the committee and in a kind of formal setting and be able to get their voice across. But of course, if it's not suitable for the young children, it won't be happening.
Yeah, no, it's just if you think about the vast majority of children now going to hearings being between ages of 5 and 12, do you know what I mean? So an environmentalist can be quite intimidating as well.
I think it could be a mix of both.
No, I don't know. I know you do come out because you have come out before.
Okay, thank you. Boyd?
Kate mentioned we've set up a young person's board. I think we're in the process of setting up a young person's board, and it may not be a board, but it's some way off young people with care experiencing feeding into SCRA, to the CHS, and also into the hearing system more generally. But we don't want to duplicate the work that's been done with the Care Council, that Who Cares supports. There are other organisations that do exist. But we have an engagement with Who Cares, so they take part in the pre-service training of new panel members. They are... We do engage quite a bit, and the work on the better hearings that was mentioned in some of the evidence is actually taking what young people said, I think at the Cobrandon 50th lecture a few years ago. They said, we've been saying these things for years, but we're waiting for action to happen. And the better hearings work, I think, is an important way in which we can move forward in responding to young people's concerns.
I'm going to move on now to Colin. I'm coming back to you, Colin. Would you like to ask the questions that you asked earlier on, please?
Yeah, I mean, based on some of the personal experiences I've had with safeguarders, I'd be interested in learning a little bit more. I don't know if there's anybody specifically around the table with the answers to this. How they're chosen, what training specifically they receive, and does the system of safeguarders work? Is it effective?
Okay, Malcolm, you wanted to come in there.
The 2011 Act gave the management of safeguarders to Scottish Government, and they've tendered it to Children First. They have standardised, and I think this was an important issue, standardised the selection and training of safeguarders, where previously there was very haphazard systems in some authorities. So unquestionably, there's a greater standardisation, a greater openness, a good dialogue with agencies because there's one national representation. The core issue you've asked is, does it work? And the Scottish Government have commissioned research from Strathclyde University, which I think is due to report fairly soon, which will hopefully give us some further clues on that issue. I can certainly speak to individual contributions of safeguarders, which have been immensely important in forming the direction the future direction of a child's future by presenting a sort of independent overview. So there's some good skill out there, but in terms of the overall pattern, I hope we'll get further clues from that research that's been done.
How does the system work in terms of a decision to appoint a safeguarder? Does the hearing decide that there has to be a safeguarder? Is there that sort of pool that they decide to mm-hmm. take someone from? Yeah. Do they determine that this person's got certain skills or whatever, or is it just next person in the pool comes up as safeguarder?
A safeguarder can be appointed by either a pre-hearing panel, a children's hearing, or a court, and one of the important changes that's been made by the 2011 Act is that once that safeguard is appointed, then they sit on all the proceedings until the end, whereas in the past, sometimes you had different safeguarders appearing for the court and hearing. In terms of how they're appointed, then Children First operate more or less on a taxi rank. So it's the next one in the queue, rather than specifically identified individuals. So I think the intention of that is to ensure that all safeguarders should have the same breadth of skills and knowledge, and equal experience needs to be given.
But at this point, the jury is a little bit out as to whether they actually do the job.
Well, it'd be interesting to see what the research says, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, Kate, do you want to come in and then Jennifer?
Can I just say the 2011 Act, I think that from a local authority social work perspective, we welcome the standardisation and the consistency that Children's First have brought to the safeguarding. They have inherited a historical position. That actually, that when safeguarders were commissioned, that the level of standards weren't at the table. They were managed corporately within local authorities, and we weren't necessarily and we're sitting outside social work services for lots of obvious reasons, because they needed a level of independence. They are working really hard to kind of change the culture. But actually, if I kind of have to reflect on our own responses from Social Work Scotland, there remains a confusion about the role. And I think that is something that we need to work through at time. And it's interesting when you get a point of conflict within the hearing room, you're more likely to get a solicitor, a safeguarder brought in, and sometimes that delays the decision making for the children. And actually, we know that that's become an issue around permanence planning, when the point of default is to ask a safeguarder. Social workers really struggle with that, because it's almost as if the report that they've presented isn't robust enough for them to make a decision. And certainly in times that has been the case, I have looked at the reports personally myself, and I've been surprised about why we would ask for a safeguarder. And I think that is about confusion, and I do think adversarial situations deal with that. One of the issues that, whilst the 2011 Act has been great, in terms of the role of social workers and getting access to safeguarders' reports, we don't get access to safeguarders' reports. Sometimes the first time we see it is at the hearing. And we're working in the presumption that the safeguarder, they may well have consulted us through the report phase, but they're going to let us know what the outcome and the recommendation. And that's not consistent nationally. So actually, the start of the trail is for the social worker to act on behalf of children's hearing system to develop a report. But as soon as that report or whatever the decision is made, they're not kept up to date with it. Yet they are sometimes the individuals that are having to manage some of the dynamics within the family, particularly when the family or the parents will come back and say, the safeguarder says this, and that might be the first time that the social worker hears. So there is a need for more clarity around the role of safeguarders.
Okay, thank you. Jennifer?
The concerns that I raised at the beginning as well that have been spoken around the room about the misunderstanding of roles. And in the research that we undertook about safeguarders specifically, it revealed those things Kate was saying, just specifically in relation to panels choosing to request a safeguarder when there's conflict in the hearing, and panel members misunderstanding the role of social workers but also social workers misunderstanding the role of perhaps safeguarders and panel members. One of the recommendations that came out was to look at ways in which panel members' confidence in the decision-making process itself can be strengthened, which I know is part of a whole range of efforts being undertaken at the moment, but that panel members themselves recognised that there was some decision to take to request a safeguarder when the decision felt too difficult to make at that time, not necessarily because the quality of the reports weren't sufficient.
Okay, thank you very much. My final question, I suppose, is primarily aimed at you, Boyd. It's about the feedback loop. How is it working in practice, and how valuable is it to ensure that the compulsory supervision orders create good outcomes for our children?
I think I have to apologise to the committee for landing 220 pages on you 2 days before this round table. But we were in the process of preparing this first report, and we thought it was better to get it out so you can see. It's been a major challenge to just identify what information is captured within local authority systems. We've had support from SCRA and local authorities in pulling this together, but as the report highlights, I think we do not have routine oversight of how hearings decisions are being implemented. We've only been able to capture from the data presented to us information around 1% of compulsory supervision orders. So there's a programme of understanding better how we capture that information routinely. That's not to say that social workers and line managers are not working with the children, but the management information just doesn't seem to be there. And there's an awful long lead-in time. So I think we've started, we've established a baseline. There are areas for improving. The Act gives me authority to stipulate what information should be provided, but I need to understand, A, what is meaningful, B, what the impact is going to be on local authority staff providing this. So I don't think it's working yet, but I think we've started a process, but as we have no data ourselves, we're very dependent on other organisations.
At this stage, it's kind of pointless then if you only get 1% of the results from the supervisory office.
I think even for those 1% going to secure care authorisations, there are issues that the report is beginning to highlight that we need to understand better what is happening in practice. And we are working with the data collectors to move to more all compulsory supervision orders, but we've quite a way to go. The next report we think will come in June, because we've now gone through the process first time. There'll be another report next year based on the data that we can capture at the moment. So it's a lengthy process, and I don't think the feedback loop is working as Parliament originally intended, but we're starting on it.
Okay, thank you for that. And if anybody wants to read that 220-page document, it was laid in Spice on Monday. Can I just thank everybody for their attendance this morning? That was another useful session. Before we do, I want to thank you all. We have the Minister appearing before the committee in a fortnight, and certainly some of the issues that were raised today will be coming up with Mr. MacDonald. And depending on what the children say, Daljeet, then we may well be speaking to some of the young children next week. Okay, and we will be speaking to some teachers next week who have dealt with the system. Thank you very much for your attendance, and thanks for your evidence.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh yeah, and I close the formal session, my apologies.